Well, welcome to the last session, the closing keynote for MIPFormats. It's been a fascinating couple of days, I'm sure you'll agree. Thanks for staying with us. It's a testament to the power of All3's global brand that it's built so much on the back of formats. And Steve Morrison started his career in the factual television business with World in Action. He ran Granada, and then he created an amazing business which operates a federal approach, allowing individual companies in their different markets around the world to develop and create their own businesses, and then he aggregates the sum of the parts. Before, I'd like to welcome onto the stage Wayne Garvie, who's the MD of International Production for the group, and Stefan Oelze, who runs Filmpool in Germany. They've joined us to discuss some of the issues that Steve will be talking about in his address together at the end of the keynote. And before I introduce Steve Morrison, I think we'll just take a look at the format brands that make All3Media what it is. So can we play the clip, please?
Cases of Doubt increased its time slot average on RTL since August 2009 by 83%, a lead of more than 10% over the second best competitor. Families at the Crossroads increased its time slot average on RTL by 80%. Germany's biggest hit show on daytime television of the past 7 years. In Two with Kalvas, psychology comes to life. Niedrig and Kunt, detectives investigate. Real police work mixed with action drama. The X Diaries. Real people on their real holidays.
Yeah, I don't get it. Me and Mark will only be over when I say it's over.
Emotional, economical.
Oh, shut up.
Thank you, David, for that introduction, and to Read Medem, and congratulations on your second year of the MIPFormats Festival, and also, of course, to C21. Well, good afternoon, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be invited to talk to you here today about innovation, about expansion of TV formats, and the creation of a new hybrid program genre. I'm going to start off with a little story, if you will bear with me. Almost 40 years ago, in January 1972, I was a student at the British National Film School, and I suggested making a film about Northern Ireland. For those of you who are old enough to remember it, the Northern Irish Parliament had just been suspended, and I arrived in Belfast to find myself in the middle of a huge march from the Harland and Wolff shipyards to the town hall. Being a first-year student, I had come up with a crazy plan to film two families, one Catholic, the other Protestant, separated by a quarter of a mile of tribal hatred. Interestingly, we had to get the permission of the British Army and the IRA to make this film. Our format, as of course we would now call it, although we didn't know the word then, was that we would film the two families in three different ways. The first would be observational. We would ask them to each take in our two-person crew to live with them in their small homes, and we would string up some cables, shoot on quarter-inch videotape with the material being broadcast simultaneously live on portable TVs in their kitchens so they could see what was being shot at any time. Yeah, all this did take place 40 years ago. The second phase was what we called in those days agitprop, where we asked our subjects to use the crews in any way they wanted to say whatever they wanted to the British public, which of course was an invitation they took up with gusto. And the third phase was to take both families to the edit suite so they could see how the films were turning out and to be filmed in discussion with each other. I suppose you'd call that reconciliation. As we had two crews living a quarter of a mile apart, I spent a lot of my time being a driver between the two houses. And one night, I arrived at the Catholic house at 1 a.m. The crew in this house was Ben Lewin, a polio-afflicted Australian who later became a Hollywood feature film and TV director and actually my best man, and Dina Hecht, a very pale Israeli, both of whom were fast asleep on the sofa. "Come in, Steve," said Rita, the pint-sized matriarch of the house. "We're just having a can of Carling's lager. Do you want to join us?" Well, how could I refuse? At this point, Rita turned to Jimmy, her mild-mannered philosophical husband, and said, "Jimmy, what would you do if the IRA came down the street tonight?" Realizing that something volcanic was about to happen, I kicked Ben and Dina, who roused and started silently filming. "What do you mean, Rita?" said Jimmy. "They aren't coming down the street tonight." "No, but if they were, would you keep a gun in the house to protect me and the bairns?" "A gun? What would I be doing with a gun?" "Well, you'd be practicing, Jimmy, so we would be ready." "Rita, if I was practicing with a gun and they heard about it, they would be coming down the street tonight." "Well, that's the problem with you, Jimmy. You're a moderate." "And what is a moderate? Define it for me." "Well," he paused, A moderate is someone who doesn't go to extremes." "Yes, it's the moderates like you, Jimmy, that let these extremists rule our lives because you're so bloody moderate. And anyway, you're the educated one. Why didn't you stay on at school and go on to university? If you had, we wouldn't be living here waiting for the IRA to come down the street in the middle of the night." "Rita, if I'd gone to university, I'd never have even met you." Now let's cut to the Protestant house. On our first day, we were introducing ourselves to Harry Fletcher, a shipbuilder and trade union shop steward, in the front room of his house. He was in a singlet vest, shaving in the living room mirror. We were explaining to Harry our filming philosophy of the three strands when the door opened and in came his wife. Peggy was a cleaner during the week, but on a Saturday, she got her hair done and she was looking immaculate. "Harry, what on earth are you doing?" "Oh, hi, Peg. I'm just being filmed by these guys. You know, they're filming us going about our daily lives." "What are you talking about, Harry? What sort of thing are they filming? And what are you doing in your underwear, shaving in the living room?" "Well, we've got Mick and Fiona coming round for tea as usual, and we'll just have it on our knees in front of the TV, and they'll film us." "Harry, we don't have our tea on our knees. We have our tea in the dining room." Harry looked bemused. "What dining room, Peg?" "You know, the dining room, the room between the living room and the kitchen where we always have our dinner." "That's the box room, Peg. We've never had our dinner in there. It's full of boxes." Peggy looked as if she was about to explode. So I broke the golden rule of observational documentary and interrupted, which you're not supposed to do. I didn't want to provoke their divorce or our eviction. "Mrs. Fletcher, is the problem not whether you eat your dinner in the living room or the dining room, but you don't want to be filmed eating your dinner in the living room?" "That's correct," replied Peggy. "That's exactly what I said." So why am I telling you all of this dialogue 40 years from 40 years ago? Two reasons. Firstly, I learned much more about the conflict in Northern Ireland through the culture of these two working class families living a quarter of a mile apart in identical houses than I did from all the news bulletins. It was almost Weberian the way they revealed how different they were in their social behavior. The Catholic family's household was always open. There was at least 6 children and sometimes 12 playing in the doorway or on the street. The front and back door were open, so the house seemed part of the street as people used it as a shortcut to get from one street to another. As neither Jimmy or Rita had a job, the house was alive for 18 hours of the 24, with their philosophical exchanges usually accompanied by a can or two of Carling's lager. Meanwhile, in the Protestant household, nothing happened for 20 hours out of the 24, as either Harry and Peg were out working or they were asleep. Only between 6 and 10 p.m. and Saturday afternoon was there any dialogue. And if someone came from the shipyard to speak to Harry on a work matter, he would walk out of the door into the street rather than bring his colleague into the house. In the end, we made all this into a 2-hour film, and I suppose had we known what we know now, we would have called it by a format, reality drama, or some other newfangled term. The second point is, what has all this got to do with today? Just after I finished this film in 1974, a German production company called Filmpool started in Cologne. 37 years after it was set up, i.e. now, today, Filmpool's scripted entertainment department, or as they call it, real fiction, will break the barrier of producing 1,000 hours of original programming in this genre in 2011. That's 7 daily strands of approximately 120 to 140 episodes each, equaling 950 to 1,000 episodes a year. This must make Filmpool Europe's leading producer of daily program strands. Not only that, but their series such as Cases of Doubt and Families at the Crossroads, as you heard on the clip, achieve audience shares as high as 37% on RTL, when the channel average for these slots is only 19%. It's a privilege for me to sit in the cockpit of All3Media, looking across the world at our 20 different companies and see such innovation and expansion as in our German company. And I congratulate Stefan and his team. Stefan is on the panel today with Wayne Garvie, our Managing Director of International Production, and I'm sure Stefan will elaborate on how they do it. Put simply, as I understand it, they take real stories, turn them into dramas, cast them with real people, not professional actors, and shoot them. That's the episodes, not the people. Very inexpensively done every day. And now they're in pre-production with the next development of this hybrid format, which is a reality soap called Berlin Day and Night, which starts this summer on RTL2. Meanwhile, over in England, up in Liverpool, from totally different origins, another strand of real drama was beginning in Lime Pictures under creative director Tony Wood. Many of you will know Lime as the company that has produced Hollyoaks, Britain's leading youth drama, on Channel 4 for 14 years. With their expertise in youth and children's drama, Tony had become interested in American dramality, such as The Hills, and had produced for MTV an English series called Living on the Edge. Interestingly, Tony and Lime style is totally different from Stefan's team in Cologne. In Cologne, the stories are fully scripted, but look like actuality, real documentary, whereas in Britain, Tony's method is unscripted, but looks like drama with highly stylized lighting and very intimate close-ups. Very intimate indeed on occasion. Not to be outdone, down in London, Stephen Lambert, or at Studio Lambert, was planning a series called 7 Days, following 12 characters in London's fashionable Notting Hill. There, the technique was much more like observational documentary, with the added element of constant interaction between the characters and Channel 4's viewers on screen and online. And over in LA, in California, Zoo Productions were developing their kind of constructed reality with shows like Southern Fried Stings and, soon to be seen, The World's Worst Tenants. I know this because all these companies are part of All3Media, yet inventing in their own style like a coat of many colors. Where does all this creativity stem from, and why is it happening now in so many different countries? If we go right back to the very beginning, in the 1930s, when documentary filming began, there were two broad schools of thought. One was called after a Scottish journalist called John Grierson, and the other followed in the footsteps of an ethnographic filmmaker called Robert Flaherty. Grierson was a journalist. He believed that you went out to interview the participants in the story, you wrote down their answers, and then you scripted word for word the interview, question and answer, and then you returned with your cameras, and in those days, of course, they weren't light cameras handheld. It was a bus line of outside broadcast trucks and big lights. You could have called that scripted reality, but what it was called then was journalism on film. Flaherty's method was completely different. He would take a camera into a remote jungle, and rather like David Attenborough would do with animals, he would observe as unobtrusively as possible tribes, hunters, and fishermen in their own habitat. He would then bring the rushes back and sit watching them for a very long time before he worked out the film that he was intending to make. This was also real drama, but with no script. It was the casting that counted and the authenticity of behavior that he wanted to capture. These two traditions, the journalistic one and the observational one, have carried on through the last eight decades to where we are today. And along the way, they veered off into drama documentary and other variations. But now, thanks to the lightness of cameras and mobility of modern television, they've become real drama, shot quickly and inexpensively. And it's no accident that more channels have taken them up in the last few years. Not only do they excite audiences, but they're also a marriage of creativity with economy. If a channel transmits a successful real drama at half the cost of a so-called proper drama, then they've doubled their return on their investment in that slot. And it's very likely that Filmpool's daily strands will eventually migrate into access peak time and then mainstream peak as this genre takes off. Meanwhile, seeing what Tony Wood was doing in England, I asked him to pair up with Ruth Wrigley, who's a senior entertainment executive producer at All3Media. So now we had another hybrid, the dramatist and the entertainer. Ruth had cut her teeth on Britain's first version of Big Brother, and the result was The Only Way is Essex. Now, I don't know if you know where Essex is. It's the capital, the fake tan capital of England, just outside London. And they launched The Only Way is Essex, a series that launched on ITV2 last year. And although directed at a young audience, scored a cultural and commercial hit way beyond the elusive light viewers they were intending to attract. We even had Peter Afton, the culture correspondent of the Financial Times, writing an article called The Chilling Truth About the Vajazzle. May I quote, "This is a bewitching mixture of feminine intimacy, Swarovski crystals, and glue. But this column," he wrote, "rarely interested in ostentatious displays of sexual decoration, is more piqued by the form of storytelling that is being celebrated in The Only Way is Essex. A relatively new hybrid, the reality soap is one of the genres that is destined to be era-defining." This is his words, not mine. "The traditional soaps struggle on, but their over-actorly intensity and pot-boiling storylines frequently take them to absurd realms. But the reality soap squares the circle. We get the story, but we also get the authenticity." And here's the bit that you won't believe. The Financial Times culture correspondent likened Essex to the Italian neorealist movement in post-war filmmaking, which he said came to similar conclusions about twinning loosely framed narrative with natural performances. Well, if it's good enough for the Financial Times, it's good enough for me. Little did Tony Wood and Ruth Wrigley know that they were following in the steps of Rossellini. Okay, enough culture. Here comes the commercial. I don't believe these experiments I've described have happened simultaneously in four different countries in All3Media simply by accident. I believe the model that David mentioned, the federal devolved model we employ, which encourages creative diversity in 20 different companies and their 30 different creative centres, has more chance of bubbling up this kind of fertility than a more integrated one-company top-down approach. There are up to 500 programme ideas developed each year across the All3Media group, and 250 of those are selected to engage with national broadcasters, and 150 are commissioned into programme series. And that's, I believe, a very high conversion rate. In the last 2 years, All3Media International has exported 50 new original formats around the world, some of which I'm sure you know, like Undercover Boss, The Cube, Cash Cab, and many more. But that's enough from me. Now it's up to you to decide whether this model of innovation, expansion, and hybrid genre making really works. Thank you very much.
Steve, if you could come and join us, we'll talk about some of the issues that you raised there. And it was fascinating how you balance this this hybrid model, this federal approach to production. How, because it is probably unique in the sector. Most companies that converge share a development process that's managed a lot more tightly. What's the benefit and what's the hardest part of letting the satellite operations build their own creativity but manage it from the centre? How do you pick what to develop? Because you do have this rolling top 10 development list.
Well, the great asset of it is that you get many more ideas. You're not exporting one or two big formats a year. You might have 20 in a year or 50 in 2 years. And there's a lot of new creativity going on around the group. The difficulty is how do you harness it? Because most ideas are developed for national broadcasters in conversation with commissioners and national channels. So Ruth Wrigley, that I mentioned, who's here tonight, sits looking across the whole group's formats with Wayne, who's looking at their potential for international production. And we've got a digital media director called Andy Taylor, who's looking at every idea to see what's the multimedia potential in this. Ruth then runs something called the Rolling Top 10, which is her very personal view of what she thinks are the biggest ideas or the most interesting, attractive, internationally capable ideas of the 500, which is quite a task. And those ideas are lifted up by her and Wayne and positioned, discussed with All3 International to see how should we export them from country to country, shared with our companies in different countries so that they know what's been developed before it even reaches the screen, so that they can prepare their way of doing it. So you might get an Undercover Boss made in English, in American, in German, in Dutch, in Australia, etc. But those companies will know about these ideas as they're bubbling up before they actually get transmitted.
How does that feed back down the pipeline to you, Stefan? I mean, are you aware as a sort of a satellite that really was responsible in many ways for what Steve is positioning as really the next big thing, the constructed reality genre? Are you aware that you're playing as part of a team, and how does that inform your own development process locally?
I think the good thing about how we work is that it's always a two-way street. So we have regular catch-ups, regular calls. There's a constant exchange of ideas. Steve mentioned Ruth. There's Stephanie Hartog also, who is in charge of formats. So I think the interesting thing is really it works in two ways. We get inspiration what the other companies are doing. I hope we do inspire in what we are doing. And I think in that way it's a very good process, not just looking at the UK and Germany, but also at the other territories.
So what's on the rolling top 10, Wayne?
I couldn't possibly tell you.
It's a secret.
I just want to come back to one of the things Steve was strangely modest there, which is a great gift, because he came up with a model, or he understands what creative people like. And if you look at the All3 model, this is absolutely works for creative people. On the one hand, you do get absolute financial rigor, which is why the group works so well. But it's the creative freedom of which people respond to. And that's why he's built something rather unique, and why people stay with the Federation. I mean, that's really interesting. So when you talk to people and you talk about the role, you know, you are working with people who by choice are there. And what we never do is what some people do, which is you get loads of companies in a room together in which each person is kind of suggested they might lift their skirts and show their wares, but the skirts are never lifted enough, I believe, in some of the international groups, so you never really know what's going on.
You never know what's underneath.
We're much more Victorian in that
we're way, much, aren't we? We're much more collaborative because people are actually wanting to be part of the process.
Right. How do you say no in that environment? I mean, how do you pick what works and what doesn't work?
We don't say no if we know that companies in one country are competing with something similar. We don't stop one company from developing their idea and say, leave it to the other company, because our intelligence is something that we don't want to betray if, say, a number of companies are working in a similar arena in one country. We would share it with our companies internationally because they're not competing, but we would hold it confidential in the country that it emerged. But we would never say to a company, don't develop that. Our job really is much more to build up and position it so that it gets bigger rather than to dampen it. And what's happened recently is some companies are beginning to collaborate and co-produce if they think that there's a hybrid, going back to your title, that neither of them is completely across both. So you might get something like a comedic soap where one company is very good at comedy, but it's more conventional half-hour comedy, and the other company may have produced thousands of episodes of a daily soap. They might voluntarily, or we might suggest, they might like to work together with the writer's team and the whole story lining of it, and then if they wish to, they do that.
So, Stefan, what do you take back out of the sort of the federal group? You know, you're working, I imagine, to your local broadcaster's tastes, to your own production budgets, and to what you feel your local market wants. What's the benefit? Do you feel that you have to say yes to this new collaboration, or how do you get involved in or out on when things come down the line or are pushed up the line?
Well, we're looking naturally at everything that's been produced and developed in this federation, and there is a very clear formats business in this. My colleague Nico Palzo, who runs MME, I can see in the audience as well, is sitting there, who's just had an incredible success with Undercover Boss. Clearly a very successful format that has come our way, that we are privileged to pick up, to produce, to adapt in the marketplace, so it works in Germany. We're doing the same with the Cube, so all the kind of formats that we see coming from across the different companies in the group, we're looking to place, and that is clearly an advantage in a formats-driven market. The German market is more an outlooking market than an in-looking market. At the same time, with what we're doing at Filmpool, that is original development. This is something that has started in Germany and is now proving to be successful internationally.
Wayne, I suppose your job is to take what you have created and spotted as a trend and then take it bigger.
Yeah.
And I think, Steve, in our previous conversation, you talked about markets like the UK and Germany being the trend spotting, and then America being the sort of the amplification. So America's very often the sort of the big prize.
Yes.
How do you develop this constructed reality genre for the US? What moves are afoot, or what things do you need to do to take it there?
Well, I think what's quite interesting, because there have been some examples of this programming in America, the Hills people talks about. But what if we just take Essex at the moment, I think Essex is different because it's an entertainment piece. Actually, its comedy is at the heart of what it does. And secondly, it's very immediate. So they're filming while the show is on air. And that is completely different to the way these shows are normally constructed, which is actually very difficult if you're a drama producer. If you're a drama producer, the idea that you're going to film something on a Monday and transmit on a Sunday is absolutely terrifying. You can't spend 4 days editing one particular sequence in an edit suite. But what that also does is it gives you a wonderful opportunity digitally to actually increase the audience's appetite for the content that's linked to it. So I think that's what's different on this. And also I think the next thing is, how do you take this interesting genre and turn it from something that is absolutely playing in the cable heartland of America and turn it into something that can work in peak for networks. And it's the same thing in the UK. How are we going to take something that is utterly huge for ITV2 and can we make something that works equally well and is bigger for ITV1?
We've heard an awful lot over the last couple of days about the fact that consolidation may be a threat to the formats business. A lot of the delegates here today and those that took part in the survey said that they felt that consolidation was perhaps the most difficult thing they were going to have to deal with, whether they were a broadcaster or a producer. And a lot of that was about product supply line, you know, the ideas coming through and having access to those. How do you create the correct fertile environment for development? Do you have a format for development or do you pitch it in?
I mean, again, I think it comes down to the basic philosophy. I was formerly doing a very similar role at BBC Worldwide, and our biggest frustration as we tried to grow an international production business was the pipeline. It's all about the pipeline. Where are your ideas coming from? And I tip up at All3Media, and I genuinely cannot believe the fertility of ideas that we've got coming through. I suppose our job really is to take a company like Maverick, who are a brilliant company, full of ideas that are absolutely innovative and lead the world in particular areas of health and fashion and lifestyle, and work with them on thinking, how do we take them from there to there? How do we create an environment in which they continue their creativity, but also how do they create global brands, because that's the world we're living in now. Television is all about global television brands.
Steve, there's been a lot of talk recently about All3Media. Is it for sale? Is it not for sale? I'm sure that they could go round the block a million times about it, but I think what I'd like to address here today in terms of building value within a content brand is where are the sweet spots, sale, no sale, refinance or not, to build a global production brand? Is it branded entertainment? Is it social media? Is it retaining your executives and inspiring them to develop the next big thing? Where are you sort of putting your value over the next few years?
Well, number one, I think it's widely known, we have announced last week that we've appointed UBS to do a strategic review. And the point of that review is to take us on to our next stage. Actually, it will be our third stage of growth, because we've had two very good private equity partners before, a smaller one when we started and a big one now in this phase. So the real issue is, what's the right route and the right partner to go to the next stage of growth? And it will be to become a more global company. Now, that doesn't matter if you haven't got ideas. Ideas is the currency of what we're all doing. And therefore, when we started out, we chose deliberately this model, a rather decentralized, coat of many colors model. Companies, as you mentioned, with executives who are all very different, had their own style, had their own creative tone in what they did. So Stephen Lambert, his company makes shows in the manner of the kind of shows that he's actually always made. So from Wife Swap to Faking It to Secret Millionaire to Undercover Boss, they're fantastic, well-cast docs, basically, almost observational docs in a format. Maverick is totally different. They're very female-facing, very young. Objective are very comedic. MME has got in Filmpool the most incredible engine for daily production. So I think the secret here is diversity, versatility. The secret is lots of ideas, lots of different executives, all feeling they're in their own companies, but harbored by a bigger group. So we always say, don't be in the Soviet Union in a very integrated company. Don't be in the Wild West out on your own. Be in a situation where you get freedom, but you also get support. And I think that is the management model of All3, and we should continue that and grow that more globally.
What about America? Is it the jewel?
America is, as you suggested, the megaphone. So Britain, we're very lucky in Britain, and we're also in Holland, and we're also in Germany, and we're also in New Zealand and Australia, we're very lucky to be in countries which are springboards for ideas. But if a show has been on in America, it will be magnified around the whole world. So Undercover Boss would have sold, but it was on Channel 4 initially. Then it goes on CBS, 38 million viewers. That is a totally different proposition. So I think it's springboard, megaphone, and then round the world. Now here, this is a very interesting insight you've raised as to how the group works, because we don't send all the IP across the Atlantic to one American All3Media company. We encourage companies that think they're capable of running their own branch company in America. And we've had six this year producing in America. Well, out of 20, that's not bad. And we might end up at 7, 8, or 9 All3 companies in a kind of All3America, sort of harbored and umbrellaed by Wayne and Nancy Tellum to make it bigger in America. That's all part of the kaleidoscope of the All3Media strategy.
Now, Nancy joined the board recently to I imagine, help facilitate growth. What's her most important piece of early advice?
Well, I think she loves the model, actually. She came to visit me when I was in a tiny office in London in a kind of social services cubicle. And she said, I watched this from Hollywood. How does this work? I mean, she just flew in from LA to discuss this. I was quite amazed because she was then the president of CBS television. So I think at the time we had about 7 companies and I had to explain how it went. So she's followed this, if you like, model, this management model, and she's absolutely fascinated by it because I think Wayne said, creative people like working in smaller companies whose identities they understand, who are local, who are part of their family of creativity. And All3Media is something behind that, but it's not sending down messages, you have to do this or you have to do that. And I think Nancy would like, with Wayne's drive as well, to build that kind of thing up in the States.
Okay, well, we're coming into the last couple of minutes now. I'm not going to open it up for questions because we're just so packed against time, but I am going to ask Steve one final question. What's the biggest challenge that is in the way of you doing what you want to do at the moment? What's the biggest problem that you've got, if any, and what are you going to do about it?
To be honest, I hope this doesn't sound smug, but I don't think we have a problem. We have to do more and more of what we do, continue with the fertility, get it out to all the very kind people who come along today, and to the channels around the world. And I think we will see, as the next few months and years go by, more and more formats being generated in this kind of coat of many colors style. And to answer your question, if you do it in this kind of model, I don't think we need to be frightened of consolidation, because I'm finding now more and more channel groups are coming to us and saying, we see we're already working with 6 or 8 of your companies. Can we put it all up to a higher level and dedicate more time to you and what you're doing and to our channels? That doesn't suggest to me that consolidation is blocking the pipeline. If anything, it's expanding the pipeline.
Do you expect to see that as other companies consolidate in a more traditional way, that might actually throw out further opportunity for you? Are you looking for the people that don't want to consolidate to come and join your federal
Well,
model?
If there are any creative talents out there who would rather be running their own company in All3Media, here we are.
Heard it here first. I'm just going to leave it there, but we're not going to finish now. We've got one more minute left, and I'd like to, before I thank Steve and Stefan and Wayne, invite Laureen, Head of Television at Reed Medium, just to say we want some closing words at the end of the conference. Laureen, please.
I'd first like to thank Steve Morrison for the very insightful, enlightening keynote and the excellent conversation. So interesting, it's too bad to stop it, with Wayne Garvie, Stefan Oelze, and of course you, David. So it's time to close, but I guess that does happen at one point always. First and most important, thank you so much all for having joined us. I really hope at Reed Medium that it was a productive and pleasant event for you. We'll be asking you for your feedback. It's so important to us to know the good and the less good so we can make it better. And I would now like to thank, sincerely thank, our partners, C21 Media, David Jenkinson, for all the work, hard work, lovely, great participation over these 2 days, and the months of preparation. I would like to warmly thank Virginia Mausler from The Wit. Yes. Our friends from the Entertainment Masterclass and from Frappa. And a special, yes, I applaud all of you, really. And a special thank you to David Lyle for his active support and contribution throughout. And also thank you to 7-1 International, our partner, for today's networking lunch. To all of you again, thank you. Hope you have an excellent MIP TV and hope to see you back next year. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Lorene. And I'd just like to close by saying, you know, it's the end of play on a very sunny Sunday. And thank you so much for staying with us and All3Media for playing it out right to the end. Steve, it's been a pleasure. Stefan and Wayne, well done. Thank you very much.